Okay. Well, first of all, greeting from Geneva. I'm sorry I couldn't be with you in person. A lot is happening here at the LHC. What I'll try to do in this talk is to give you a feeling about our physics program, where we are, what we do in terms of handling the data and getting the results out, some of the challenges we face, and I'll make sure to include allusions to our exercises in terms of beginning to use machine learning, deep learning, and various recent forms of neural networks to help us with our search. And as far as the looking forward is concerned, we intend to do more of that. And so I think there are areas and lots of opportunities for collaboration. It's about the discovery of the Higgs boson, which took place in July of 2012. And that discovery, where the director general, the former director general, are there on the left in the picture, announcing the discovery, that and the confirmation that it was the Higgs boson predicted by the Standard Model of Particle Physics led to the Nobel Prize in 2013. And this seems to have global impact. For example, the Science magazine called it the breakthrough of the year, and for some, it was the breakthrough of the century so far. So this was a 50-year trek from the first theoretical ideas to conceptualizing the experiments, to beginning to construct them, now 15 years ago, to the first operation of the accelerator and the discovery. Throughout this time, advanced computational methods and networks were essential for the discovery, but also for every PhD thesis in the course of the program. And that will be just as true in the future. And given the challenges, we're looking forward to using new innovative methods to get to make our discoveries, but perhaps with less computational power, less energy, and more control over what we're doing. On the next slide, I try to give a snapshot of the LHC, if you see that yet. So within the LHC, bunches of protons pass through each other every 25 nanoseconds. That is, there are bunch crossings at 40 megahertz. And as the intensity of the machine went up from the first stages of operation, first we had an average of two interactions per crossing of the bunches, shown in the middle top, then in 2011, seven, in 2012, 21. Right now, running at somewhat higher energy, near the design energy, we've got up to 30 interactions per crossing, and that's just the start of a longer-term evolution that will end up in a second major phase of the program about 10 years from now, when we raise the intensity further with major design changes to the accelerator, resulting in incredibly dense events with 140 to 200 interactions for a single crossing. On the right, you see some of the things that we deal with using our traditional methods of going from the raw data to the quantities that we then select on and reconstruct to form what represents the particles and how we identify particles and other things such as jets of particles which come from the fundamental constituents, the quarks, the gluons, as well as electrons, muons, neutrinos that are coming out. Neutrinos interact very weakly and they show up as an energy imbalance in our detector. So what you see in the upper right is a bunch of hits, and then it's a two-dimensional view of what is really an unrolled cylinder of one of our detector layers where we measure electrons and photons. You can see there are various hits. The color shows the higher energy, the color and the size, and we have to cluster them and then form the clusters in what we call superclusters and identify which are the electrons and photons. In the right middle, you see a side view, and it emphasizes what happens in the inner part called the tracker, where we, with layers of silicon, we measure the particles going through. They leave behind ionization, which is then collected and transformed into digital signals. And by looking at many silicon layers, there's 200 square meters of silicon in our tracker. We can reconstruct the tracks in space. And then in the bottom right, you can see the layers of the crystals, which measure electrons and photons, and all the hits in red and blue, showing you some of the complexity. So, Next is a picture of our detector called CMS, the compact muon solenoid. You see it's cut away to show you the various layers. When there is an interaction in the middle, then particles come out of the interaction region and pass through various layers that measure different properties, trajectories in space for charged particles. Energy is deposited in heavy materials in layers, which are then read out for electrons and photons in the green layer composed of crystals. Then the other particles, which interact strongly, called pions and kaons, deposit their energy in the next layer shown in orange. There's a very powerful magnetic field generated by a superconducting coil, which is shown in white, and that allows us to bend the particles to momentum analyze them. And the outer part of the volume is called the muon chambers, interleaved with the layers of iron to return the magnetic flux, and they measure muons, which manage to get to the outside and penetrate a lot of material. So we have different types of particles and different types of detectors. So as you can see, it's a very heterogeneous system with different types of detector technologies. There are 100 million readout channels, which are sampled every 25 nanoseconds. So if you look at the raw data and had to deal with that, it's a petabit a second, or 1,000 terabits a second. And in terms of what passes through the readout and is dealt with in online processing, it's about 50 exabytes a day, or 5 times 10 to the 19 bytes per day. So the physics processes. The advantage of the LHC is with the high intensity energy, we can get at rare signals. But unfortunately, protons, which are collided, are strongly interacting particles, and they have a lot of other interactions, starting with many interactions at a very high rate that we already know. And so here on a log plot, there are all these different kinds of processes. We check that the standard model of particle physics is really working, and it is. And the common processes that we know all about already are on the left. And as you go down the log plot, you eventually come to more interesting things. And for example, the Higgs boson channels, the different types of Higgs boson channels are on the right, down in the log plot. And there are even much more rare things, including things that it will take us another 10 to 20 years to detect. So there are many orders of magnitude of rejection required to filter out the interesting events from all the rest. And this is a great technological challenge among several. So this is a picture, a sketch of representing our online system. To filter the data, we first have this massively parallel specialized electronics infrastructure, which makes a primary selection. It takes the 40 million bunch crossings, with everyone being very complex, and selects about 100,000. Obviously, there's a very short time to do this. Then there's a higher level trigger, which is actually a software trigger to refine the selection. It's composed in CMS, at least, of tens of thousands of processors, normal commodity processors. And finally, we read out about 1 kilohertz of events after all this selection, and store that. And we operate about 1,000 hours a year, writing events at 1 kilohertz, which end up to be some tens of petabytes of events. Then what happens? Well, here you see again in this picture of the global system. I hope it comes up soon. As a global data flow, do you see that one? Okay, I'll assume you do. So from the experiment through the online system, the data is first reconstructed essentially in real time at the CERN Computer Center, and then distributed for further processing to national computer centers around the world with 1 to several times 100 gigabit a second links. And I just showed the first few. There are about 13 of those. I invented this cartoon at my desk in 1999, and there's also this idea of having tier two centers, which are dimensioned to be operated and managed at universities or smaller laboratories. And that idea really took off, and there are now 170 of those facilities, each with a few petabytes of data, and each one having several thousand cores. And then every physics group in every experiment has their own cluster called tier three, and there are about 300 of those. And typically, at these various sites, you're dealing with from 1,000 to tens of thousands of cores. So you can see that the properties of this system depend very much on the capacity of the various facilities, also how well they're connected, and also how people manage to manage their data. So the tier zero at CERN, again, does the real-time data processing. The tier ones and tier twos do both real data processing and simulated data processing because we have to compare the data to many, many hypothesized theoretical processes and models. And the tier twos and tier threes, that is the smaller university clusters, which are still pretty big, and the tier three individual group clusters are where most of the data analysis is done. As it was shown and made CERN managers happy, it looks nice and hierarchical and simple. Of course, people, scientists don't really follow this. So as time went on, this system got to be used more and more as a sort of cloud resource, namely run any job anywhere. And this is interesting because this system essentially occupies the entire world, not every continent, as was said. Because we need more resources, we increasingly use cloud resources, commercial clouds, as for peak demands, and also have started to use some of the large HPC facilities. And we'll certainly turn to the exascale facilities as they emerge over the next several years to be able, as perhaps the only way, to fulfill the last major part of our needs. This also became very much a global dynamic system. I operated transatlantic networking for about 20 years until 2015, and we made this into a global dynamic system from the network point of view. Now the whole thing is becoming more intelligent. We're developing the means for the next generation of making this an agile, software-defined intelligent system to coordinate network computing and storage resources. And controlling such a complex system is certainly fertile ground for machine learning and more. I mean, modeling and simulation, game theory, I'll come back to that at the end. So now what I'm about to show you are examples of the volume of global data flow and the expansion rate, which is well beyond Moore's law and beyond what anybody can afford. The complexity of our data and workflow, the interfacility connections, how they compose a complex system over networks of varying capacity and reliability, and how we plan to meet the challenges through the use of software-defined networking, beginning to use much better deep learning, coupled to modeling and simulation, I said, pervasive monitoring, and finally, game theory to find effective metrics to optimize a system and stable solution. So this is a snapshot of the Energy Sciences Network. It tells you what's happening with a lot of data flow in the United States. If you look in the lower left, you see a weather map, and you see that typically across the US and going through Chicago and or New York, where the two major laboratories in the US at Fermilab and Brookhaven are located. And also, of course, you see NERSC and LBNL in the lower left. You can see there's pretty heavy load. In aggregate, the typical traffic load is in the range of 150 to 250 gigabits a second, and there are peaks to more than 300. If you compare to what ESnet installed across the Atlantic is 340 gigabits a second in total, so we're not far from the wall. The growth rate over the long term since the 1990s has been remarkably steady, growing 72% a year, which is pretty remarkable, 10 times every 4 years. But recently, the growth rate has gone above that trend. The data flow grew by more than 100% in the last 12 months. And what I'm about to show you, the part of the networks which has been engineered in the last couple of years to serve the tier two centers where most of the analysis takes place, has grown by a factor of 3.5 in a single year. This is the next one, says complex workflow, to give you a feeling for what's going on. And there are four major experiments. I work on CMS. Our competitor is called Atlas, similar physics goals, different detector design in various ways. And there are two other experiments which are specialized called LHCb for measuring certain types of what are called heavy quarks, and ALICE, once a year, there's a month of colliding lead ions to study nuclear matter at extreme scales. You can see the data throughput rates, which are typically 28, and sometimes I see 40 gigabytes a second. That's gigabytes a second, so it's again your 300 gigabits a second. And it's composed mostly of organized file transfers of many, many files in what are called data sets. There are also people accessing tens of millions of object collections a day, and the number of network ports open often exceeds 100,000 through some of the what we use. One thing is called any data, anytime, anywhere, which if you if you try to manage networks, you say thanks a lot for that. So the traffic growth is again huge, 2.7 times in the last 12 months, and just during the month of April, it grew 60%. So this is way beyond Moore's law. So what are we going to do about it? Answer, invest more and more intelligence and moderate what we do. Next, you see this complicated web, it's at LHC1. It's called the LHC Open Network Environment. It was invented to interconnect the centers, especially the tier two centers. I have to admit, this is a somewhat old picture because the more recent pictures are so complicated, they don't communicate anything. But here you see many sites, and some of them are represented as clouds because some of the major networks cover many sites like ESnet in the United States, Internet2 in the United States. Géant is the pan-European network that serves all of Europe. And you see some national networks in Europe and in Asia. So in the center, you see the US, on the right, Europe, on the left, Asia, all interconnected. So the good news is the world network providers have mobilized on our behalf to help us carry out our science program in the presence of supporting many, many other science programs. The issue is it's a complex system. It has limited scaling properties. It doesn't have any particular structure. It grew organically. And, you know, if someone else comes and says, we want to do that too, the network providers don't really know what to do about that. Looking ahead, projected needs will continue to grow. So the projections are 100 to 1,000 times growth in the network needs by 2026. And so that's not within anybody's budget. If you look at the evolution of networks, there's a generational change of technology about every 7 to 8 years, and it's only a factor of 4 every 7 to 8 years. Also, as other projects come to the fore, like major sky surveys, I'll show you some. I won't have time to talk about genomics, which is another. We're going to compete with other fields and other programs for use of the world's networks. So I just took one snapshot. This is from the Large Synoptic Space Telescope, which is being commissioned and will eventually operate in Chile and be connected to its computing facility. The major one is at NCSA near Chicago. We'll go via Miami through Brazil to Chile. And so you see a cartoon, a picture of the telescope, and then an artist's concept of the facility, telescope facility in Chile in the Andes Mountains. And on the right, looking ahead further, there is a square kilometer array where you can see the many sites in Australia and South Africa with 3,000 antennae collecting data. Some are mobile, many are fixed, covering a million square kilometers and sending to the correlators to correlate all the raw data, 15,000 terabits a second or 15 petabits a second to the correlators. And from there, starting sometime in the 2020s, the first half of the 2020s, storing 1.5 exabytes a year. So we will have competition. We're also helping people, these people prepare for their network technologies and satisfying their needs. A little bit about the Higgs boson discovery is next, and the physics. And I just can give you one element of it was the discovery of the Higgs boson. Nature has done something which is interesting. It's chosen a mass of the Higgs boson so that there are many final states, many decays which can contribute. And so on the left, you see on a log plot, the branching ratio, the fraction of Higgs decays. And the more interesting ones, the ones which really stand out and we can make precise measurements, are the rarer ones. And I picked two, one very simple, where the Higgs boson goes to two high energy photons, which has a 0.2% branching ratio, 0.2% of all its decays. And there's even a rarer one, which has given us a lot of information about whether it is really the standard model Higgs boson through the way it decays. And that's a Higgs boson goes to two Z bosons. You might remember those are particles that carry the weak interaction. And each Z boson can go to a pair of what we call leptons, Z plus E minus or mu plus V minus. That's 10 to the minus 4, but it's very important for us. So for more than 20 years, since the SSC times, we've been targeting this channel, among others. And you see some of the very smart people. I can't tell you about them all. I have no time. But some of these people are extremely smart and that have contributed in various ways to this analysis. Practical keys to the discovery are precise calibration, so we can pick out the Higgs boson decays, which are relatively rare above the backgrounds. Optimizing the photon identification, precisely defining the energy scale to get the mass right, and various innovative analysis methods. It's only a few years ago that we started to do what has some overlap with machine learning, namely multivariate analyses and boosted decision trees in particular. We used to use artificial neural networks of the standard kind with single hidden layers and, directed flow through the network without any recursion or any recurrence. And Yossi Ma, who's now in the lower left and among the photos, is now at the Center for Naval Analyses. And he did the first boosted decision tree analysis of this, even before we got real data. Many other people have made tremendous contributions to this. And finally, in the upper right is Josh Ben-David, who really has sort of revolutionized this analysis through a flow chart of MVAs, and I'll tell you more about that. In the future, we also have invented some new variables for new physics searches, the RASER variables produced by a student and my colleague, Professor Maria Spiropoulou, which has particular power for finding new physics processes. In the future, we'd like to use better deep learning to kind of push forward our sensitivity and also reduce our computational burden. So one example, this is a candidate of a Higgs boson going to two photons. You see there are many tracks, and there are also these these boxes which represent energy deposited in the crystals, which measure electrons and photons precisely. And one of my former students, shown in the upper right, who graduated on this with his committee on this process. My colleague, by the way, on the right, is now working, Alan Weinstein on the very right, is now working on LIGO, and he was involved in the discovery of gravitational radiation, which is just a great thing for him. Okay, so this is a candidate. What does it mean? It means that there are signal events and there are background events, and you look for an excess above the background. So we don't really know if any individual event is a Higgs boson decay or just the background. So the analysis is optimized by categorizing the events by the quality of our ability to identify the photons, the vertex efficiency, the purity, and mass resolution. We can actually calculate signal over background likelihood event by event. We also supplement this simple signature by rarer signatures with larger signal to background, ones in which there are two jets of particles, which come from gluons, for example, which again are rarer but higher signal of background, and exclusive categories where the Higgs boson is associated with additional production of a W particle or a Z particle. Those are the weak interaction carriers, and that helps a little bit in the overall significance. So as I said, Josh Ben-David in particular carried forward this analysis. The main thing is a boosted decision tree analysis, where the main thing is a diphoton MVA, which has four event classes based on a diphoton BDT output and the additional categories. We scored each event according to probability we got the vertex right. We scored according to the estimated mass resolution, which depends upon which region the photons went into in our detector. How well we identify the photons, and also something about the diphoton kinematics, against the rest of the event because there are different topologies for the signal versus the backgrounds. So we take our measured cluster energies, the reconstructed tracks, the energy deposited, and we feed it into various MBAs for the primary vertex probability, the vertex selection, likelihood, the photon ID quality, and so on, and feed it into a diphoton MBA. And so this again shows how it works, how we get our diphoton MBA for each photon on the isolation, which in the signal events, it tends to be isolated photons because the particle that decays to create the photons is massive, so the photons don't necessarily overlap with other jets of particles in the event. The shape of the photon as we see it in the crystals, the energy density of the event, the kinematics, the topology, and we train this on Monte Carlo signal and background. So we train all this, we check that the Monte Carlo simulation has very high fidelity with respect to the real data. We get a boosted decision tree output, a score, and then we again separate it into categories. That helps us because in the high values, you get much better purity, and you find that by cutting this way and creating categories and only keeping the high outputs, the higher outputs at all, you get the maximum sensitivity. So this is an analysis from my student at the time of the discovery. What you can do is you can express the outcome in terms of the probability that the excess in the data, you saw that bump, can be explained by an upward fluctuation in the background only without a real Higgs boson. And it's become traditional after long decades of experiments that to claim a discovery and have a sufficiently low probability of a mistake, you need a 5 sigma significance, and better if 2 experiments have 5 sigma significance. So this one channel had 4 sigma significance at the time of the discovery. We were in the midst of data taking when the discovery was announced. We got 4 times the data by the end of that year and 6 sigma in this channel alone by that time. Now, the use of those MBAs in that flowchart boosted the sensitivity overall by a factor of 1.8. relative to a traditional cut and count method of making selections of the signal and then counting how many events you have. That means a lot. I mean, it's not just that we had a slight advantage, but rather it would have taken 1.8 times longer in running if we didn't have this sensitivity. We're going to go on searching for rare decays and keep looking for new things, of course, in many channels, but also in these channels, to see if there's a deviation from standard model predictions or something new showing up in rare decays of the Higgs boson. And if we didn't save this factor of 1.8, we would waste many years. So this is worth a tremendous amount to us, as one of several examples. Other things which have been done is we have theoretical models. They're represented in what are called phenomenological models, where you can randomly produce 4 vectors, momentum energy vectors of particles, following the theoretical models. Often you get these high dimensionality distributions, which have large peaks in them and are hard to represent. And so generating these things randomly is incredibly inefficient. So Josh has done many things, and one of them is to use boosted decision trees to learn optimally how to divide up an n-dimensional space into bins or voxels, if you want, and how you can, with high fidelity, represent such a difficult function. So this is a classical example of a Camel function. There's a picture, but it's really, the exercise actually is a 4-dimensional Camel function. And he finds that with respect to the previous best methods, 10 times acceleration, 10 times faster computation, but also an order of magnitude better accuracy. So we've started to deal with some of the HPC systems at Argonne to satisfy our future computing needs. And we're doing various things like to put this into our big computing grid that I showed you. But I think that these methods are sort of a return to the HPC community, that we can show value by doing these things. And this is not only useful for making our generators of particle four momenta, but also useful for any kind of n-dimensional integration. Okay, so let's go through a few areas, and many have great potential for machine learning. I'll take you through the triggering on rare signals problem, data processing and simulation problems, data movement problems, and so on. Search strategies, I already took you through part of the Higgs boson procedures that we go through. And I'll return to this question of global intelligent systems to handle our data in the course of this talk. We're starting to use data science, as I said, with the first exercises on advanced tracking algorithms, object identification, faster simulation from raw data, lower energy consumption, and so on. And then we're going to tackle our global workflow, and we have other applications which rely not just on machine learning and deep learning, but also real-time analytics. So the first thing is about reconstruction. So we get this huge amount of raw data, of digitized data, from our subdetectors, and we want to reconstruct it into the kinematics and properties of the particles that were created in the collisions. And the innermost layers, which are made of silicon, are there to produce coordinates in space from which we can reconstruct particle trajectories. And you see an example of an event on the upper left where you can see how dense it is. You see lots of tracks and track segments all over the place. Only the hits associated with tracks are shown. There are actually about as many other isolated hits. So we have lots of layers of silicon. The particle travels through these layers. We try to take all the hits in the layers and the digitized information. There are thousands of sparse hits, actually tens of thousands now. And we try to reconstruct tracks. And you can see what a mess it is, like in the lower right. So we start by seeding, and then we try following through things like a Kalman filter is one classical method. Try to pick up additional hits, get track candidates, actually make roads, and then try to make track candidates, and then try to resolve it all into what we believe are the correct tracks, move hits around, try to merge tracks, try to get it all right. In the course of this, there's an explosion in hit combinatorics in both the seeding and the stepping during the Kalman filtering to come up with the track candidates in the tracks. So it's a usually time-consuming task. And as the density of the events goes up, in spite of code improvements, the computing time tends to go up quadratically. So this is showing some of the cost. Of the computing. You see the time per event versus luminosity. As we've gone up, I showed you that we progress from 20 now to 30, soon 40 pileup events per crossing of the proton bunches. The yellow curves were the computing time per event about a year or two ago. Now with code improvements, we have the blue curve, but they still are taking off sort of quadratically as the luminosity goes up. And so by the time we reach the high luminosity LAT, the second major phase of the program, we expect our CPU needs relative to today, which is already pretty intense, are another factor of somewhere between 65 and 200. So there are two things that we're doing. One is we're attacking the use of the HPC facilities, which are not really architected for events like ours, but we're also seeking very avidly for much faster algorithms, maybe simpler in concept, and machine learning and its ability to get information and knowledge from raw data is something which is very appealing to us. This is a similar thing with a calorimeter reconstruction. So I mentioned these crystals. There are 76,000 crystals, each of which weighs something more than a kilogram, meant to absorb high energy electrons and photons. And I'll show you what happens when an electron or photon enters one of the crystals. As a result, light is produced. The light is captured in a photodetector. There's a shaping, electronic shaping, analog shaping done that gives you a pulse, which is shown in the upper middle. And we pick off various times, and then from that reconstruct the pulse, trying to get especially the energy, and also we get a time. And then you see all the hits, which I had shown before. And we have to build into clusters, then superclusters, then try to identify the photons and electrons and the many jets of particles which are in here. So this is a multi-step process. It's more and more challenging with higher pileup. And the pattern recognition, identification, regression to get the energy scale right and the resolution optimized are all very complex. And we think it could sort of be an all-in-one process if we could devote an effort on machine learning to this and see if we can actually do it all in one. So this is more about simulations. So we run simulations. This is another tremendously complex process. We have to know for every signal what are the backgrounds. And you have control regions, which are away from the candidate signals you might be looking for. You have to then project or fit so that you get the background in the signal region. So you need very large sets of simulated events for this. And also, there are many hypothesized new physics processes. So you need to do this for the signals and also huge samples for the main backgrounds, which are much more likely than the rare things that you're looking at. So simulation is a costly process. I already mentioned, first we produce the particle four vectors. They then propagate through a detailed representation of our experiment. The particles bend, they slow down, they interact with the material, they deposit energy in certain sensitive layers or particular parts of the experiment, which are then produce a light, eventually electronic signals, or ionization goes to electronic signals, and eventually digitized data. And the real CMS readout and its characteristics are also simulated. Well, that's quite a process. So here's a microcosm. One electron goes into one crystal. And what happens in the simulation? Well, all the interactions of an electron with heavy material are simulated. You generate many more electrons, positrons, and photons in the crystal. There's a process that simulates the light production, which propagates through total internal reflection to the photodetector at the end, and then it's, a pulse is produced, it's digitized. This is really complex. And that's just in one crystal of 76,000. Well, so we think this is a great opportunity, certainly a tremendous challenge for generative models with machine learning. And I'll come back to those later. Find it intriguing. We haven't done much, but it's just a great potential opportunity. But maybe we could generate the energies and topology of the entire event just from the pattern in the crystals without all the modeling, without all the simulating or what happens with real physics inside directly from the raw data. Anyway, that's a hope. So, as I said, we're starting to get into machine learning. And, I brought this up, which you all know much better than me, because I've already talked, first of all, about the power of this approach. Namely, you don't need a parametric model to get started. So this is great for cases where you don't have or find it very difficult to make a model ab initio, but you've got all this data. And then by looking at the data, maybe you can derive relationships and understand what's going on, at least phenomenologically, and maybe even get real understanding starting from the raw data. So this is a summary from Balazs Kegel, who visited CERN a couple of years ago. And if I look through the taxonomy, the various things that are done, we do some of those things, right? We have done, started to do MVA analyses a lot. We've worked with the more elementary forms of neural networks. Now we're starting to deal, we as a field, not only DLHC, are starting to deal with more recent, more powerful convolutional neural networks and other recurrent neural networks, et cetera. So in terms of unsupervised learning, we are certainly starting to deal with that. We have done traditionally clustering. We know about dimensional reduction, things like principal component analysis, kernel density estimation. These are things we've come across. But, we're beginners and we have a long way to go. And we certainly have enough to do. This is from a colleague who's really gotten fairly deeply into this, Jean-Roch Blimont, that I'll come back to at the end. So these are some examples and his hopes of more modern developments. So this is something you're probably familiar with, more than me again. Scene labeling. So there's a video output from a real-time helmet cam, and you can see all the objects being characterized, and things which are nearest neighbors are actually of the same type. So there's similarity relationships geometrically in character and so on and so forth. So you can group and classify what each pixel belongs to. And starting from just from the real-time video input, that's like our raw data in a sense. So Jean-Roch has various hopes. One is to associate each crystal energy in our experiment to a cluster just using deep learning, just using the clusters. The other is to associate each tracker hit in that mass of hits to a charged particle just with deep learning. This is an example of something like tracking. This is not from my experiment, but was shown at this very important conference in machine learning, NIPS, in 2014, showing three airplanes how they're tracked and how, you can do a ground-up sort of track reconstruction. It also shows the dangers here because there's track swapping between the two planes, and so you worry about accuracy and so on. And then there's a representation of a soccer game, trajectories of people and also the ball. So now this is a more recent thing. I found this paper really fascinating. So what's going on here, of course, I think you all recognize this, is that from scenes you're able to associate objects and you try to build sentences. And certain objects are well recognized and associations are understood. And certain things in the English language, like adverbs and prepositions and other things, are harder. So it says, person rides elephant past shop. So it understands the objects pretty well and even the relationships, but the verb of going past seems to be more difficult. And then there's a dog. Dog plays catch with the white ball near wooden fence. That's interesting. Man playing accordion among or in, it doesn't even know, among or in public area. All right. So what is the hope here? The hope here is to go directly from hits in a tracker. And here I show a result from another experiment at the LHC. It's called LHCb. And they use a gas target. You get a huge rate of colliding protons from the accelerator with a gas and create a huge rate so they can study certain types of quarks. And I couldn't give you a picture of a raw event for them. We always reconstruct tracks, but imagine. You just get the green hits in the layers and use the raw hits, not even the tracks, and get the complete particle decay out. And this is a, so here's an example. There's a recent discovery of a new type of particle that consists of five quarks that was known theoretically that it could exist for known for about 50 years, but only last year was discovered. So imagine we would want to go from the raw hits with all the reconstruction, the track finding. Then there's a sort of certain particles travel a certain distance, then the secondary particles decay. And instead of doing all that complicated topology, just go from the beginning to end in one step. We don't know. But we think it's a great area of study. So we have done certain things, pilot projects. I give credit to again to Jean-Roch and also my colleague Professor Maria Spiropoulou and a few others. So first, advanced tracking algorithms. The pilot project is instead of doing the seeding, classification, and road building, and then trying to get the tracks right, is trying to use scene labeling for scene formation and object detection for the track assembling process. It's a very high reward, medium to high risk. And right now they're trying to define the models to drive this. Jet tagging. Okay. So when a particle decays into quarks or gluons, which are among the fundamental constituents, they don't appear in nature that way. As they fly apart, they form jets of particles. And sometimes when heavy particles decay, they'll decay into a couple of jets. So if I have a top quark, it'll decay, let's say, to a W boson, a W particle, and a B quark, which is lighter than the W particle. The W particle goes to two jets. And then if the top quark is flying, if it has a certain momentum, then the relativistic boost folds everything forward. And so you've got these jets which have substructures. And we do pretty well on discriminating these things, but we're not yet taking advantage of the full substructure of the jets. There's an example of a study which was done to try to distinguish a gluon jet, which tends to go to a quark and end the quark before it does anything more, from a single quark jet. And there's been some success in studies. This is by Jean Rock, together with some students we have here for the summer, with a small data set and a schema with 11 categories. He gets about 60% accuracy on gluon jets, which is quite competitive compared to any quark jet. And this is after a short study. So it's got a long ways to go, but it's promising. Then there have been real studies for doing analysis. First, other physicists have looked at how to distinguish top quarks, which are the heaviest quarks, from the other quarks through the jet topology that they leave in the detector. And you can see in the top example, where you can see examples of some of the topologies they deal with and the clusters they deal with. And they're able to build a discriminator just from the raw data through a neural network and get good discrimination from the top quark in output. Looks like a boosted decision tree sort of to me. The top quark in red versus the other quarks in blue. More interesting is more recent use of tagging W bosons this way with a convolutional neural network. And you can see the convolutions learning the features without knowing them in advance. I think some of the filters, like the red crosses and the little thing, the little red thing at the bottom, is actually learned. And then picking out the features and pooling them in certain patterns to distinguish and learn how to distinguish the W bosons from the other quark jets. And the result is very interesting. On the right, after the training, the discrimination, the way this is the signal efficiency is on the picking out the signal is on the x-axis. On the y-axis is 1 over the background. So it's configured so that the best results are the highest curves. And the highest curve, in fact, is this max out, this convolutional neural network with max pooling at the end. And it beats everything else, including some classical thing. I mean, there's a convolutional network is sort of without this pooling, I guess, is second best. The classical Fisher discriminant method, quite classical, is the third biggest, and so on. So that's very promising. Another part of the high energy physics program, apart from the LHC, is neutrino oscillations. So one of the only things beyond the standard model that we're struggling to learn is why neutrinos traveling over long distances change their flavor. The way you know that is when they interact, they have different patterns. So from an accelerator, when you crash protons into a target, you mainly get neutrinos of the muon type, which when they interact, they create a muon which travels a long way in your detector. So you see a picture of this detector. Actually, this detector also is something which was designed and partly built at Caltech, along with Minnesota and Argonne National Lab. And actually, my colleague, young colleague, is now the head of the analysis for that one. And it shows that just from the hits, we used to do all this stuff with simulated events and trying to have a library of all possible events and match patterns as a way not to have to do the reconstruction in the classical way. But with a convolutional neural network and two views into what they call a convolutional visual network, they're able to get the patterns and learn them spontaneously without putting in any parametric models to begin with. And that result is quite striking to me because I've had a couple of students graduate doing this kind of analysis, not this one, but previous generation stuff. 40% better electron efficiency for the same background that is much faster. Next thing is really, I find fascinating. It's generative models. And, you know, we're kind of embarrassed to show this example. This is a paper, learning to generate chairs, tables, and cars with convolutional neural networks. But it's fascinating. You know, you can take some inputs and learn not only about the objects, but about how they're composed and relationships among them and among the parts, and learn relationships and eventually also generate new objects or new views or, you know, new types of objects. So what do we hope to do? Replace the complex multi-step simulation with generative models. Generative models. You have a question?
Harvey? Question. Yeah, Harvey, I just want to say you're a few minutes over. So just to let you know, if you could wrap up.
Okay. Yeah, I'm coming towards the end. I'm going to skip through a little bit. I'll say a little bit. We've looked into neuromorphic computing, and we have actual collaborations with a company and an institute in Zurich, and also IBM True North. That's another promising direction that John Locke is looking into. And so I covered faster algorithms, what we might do for triggers, faster event simulation, and so on. And then beyond the need for computation, there are other things. We work with Yandex to try to see if we could automate our data certification. So we have thousands and thousands of histograms, and we make them for every 23 seconds of beam time to make sure that everything is working well and that we don't lose any data. But we found in this study, if you look at the pollution rate of accepting bad data versus the loss rate, that if you could accept the 1% data loss, we might save 40% of the certification team's time. And this is a big team. This is also a self-organizing analysis we did. Self-organizing maps is something that we looked at, trying to look at workflow when we were first building this worldwide LHC computing model based on something called Kohonen maps, which were first proposed in Finland in the 1980s and reappeared when mobile phones appeared because of the need for self-organizing systems to look after these very dynamic and fragile networks of interconnections associated with such devices. So here's a case of a signal and three backgrounds in a synthetic study. And as you inject more and more signal on the background, you can see the significance of the signal, how it emerges, just using self-organizing maps. And this is very fast and seems to be effective. This is just promising. And this just refers to how we use similar methods in the older generation to try to make decisions looking at the load, interconnections, and capabilities of various sites throughout this worldwide grid, when we assign jobs to local sites and when we send them across networks or send the data across networks to other sites for processing using self-organizing maps. Okay, so I wanted to finally say something about the greatest challenge, which is about our worldwide data. Data management systems have been built by the experiments that distribute data, process, analyze, gather results, and assign the output to various sites. They're highly manual and manpower intensive. And also we're hitting various walls. We need to optimize our use of computing and storage resources, and we have to build intelligent systems before we hit the wall in terms of networks. But we are building software-defined systems that do this, that are beginning to do this. And we are coordinating the various resources and trying to inject increasing degrees of intelligence. So we do, again, hope to use machine learning together with modeling, simulation, and eventually game theory to build such a system. And building such a system, if we succeed, will have a major impact. I don't think there's been a global system like this before. Let me skip ahead a few, and I'll come to the last one, really. So after what we've been doing, we've been building software-defined network systems. We pretty much have the state of the art in long-distance data transfer to help drive this. We're working with computer science groups in many places. There's a very good one at Yale run by Richard Yang that we're working with to have consistent operations across intelligent networks. When we do this, we have to not only optimize operations, but we have to find effective metrics. And we thought a lot about it, and game theory seems to be a great match. I mean, it's mathematical models of conflict and cooperation among intelligent, rational decision makers. Well, we're somewhat intelligent, and I don't know how rational we are. But as individuals and as groups, you know, we compete for resources as well as collaborate. And We've seen success in many fields. And so if we can engineer a system which will have coherent interactions among the experiment's workflow management system, the insights, the network, and the user groups as a system, we did a little bit of this when we're designing the LHC computing model, it would be a real breakthrough for us. So apart from the algorithmic advances, we're also hoping for a system level breakthrough. So that's it. We're on the verge of looking for, and we hope finding what lies beyond the standard model. That's the main mission. We have another 20 years to go. To carry out our mission, we face increasing technological challenges. We hope that through the breakthrough you all have made in fields like deep learning and some of the methods that I showed, that it will really help us not only to carry out our mission, but make it more possible to expand the scope of what we do and also face some of the computational and network challenges. I just wanted to mention that to thank a couple of my colleagues who worked very much on data science recently. Maria Sparop, who did this data science workshop last year, and there'll be a follow-on workshop at the Simon Foundation, coming up. So I've shown you some of the context we're working on, including companies working on And I mentioned John Rock, who's a great guy, who's rather deeply into machine learning. David, who is the key player in formulating our work on multivariate analyses. And that's it. And I'm sorry I ran over.
Thanks. Can you hear me, Harvey?
Yeah, sure.
Harvey, can you hear me?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Yes. Since we're over time, but since we don't have Harvey here to ask him stuff during break, I figured we should go ahead with our question period. So, please use the mic for anybody.
I had a question about the nitty-gritty of the data. What is one data and what does it look like typically? Is it tagged with the particles that are interacting? How do we know that two different pieces of data correspond to the same particle? Can you give us a little insight into that?
So our data goes through many stages. So let's concentrate on the raw data because that's where the machine learning potential really is. And if we look at the raw data, what is it? It's just a digitized number, which can represent the position in space. Another number might tell you an energy. How much energy was deposited in that channel in that location. So it's positions and energies, and that's kind of it. And from that, we start to make tracks which represent the particles and how they went through space. Or we try to cluster all these individual numbers that represent energy when they're near each other into clusters. And finally, we think we've got all the energy that was deposited by an electron or a photon in neighboring cells. And then we go from there. And from this information about the individual particles, we try to understand the topology of the event as a whole, the interaction that occurred between the particles that were colliding. But it starts with very basic information, right? I think there was a recent article which was very interesting to me about nanolithography and trying to characterize the transport properties of nanoparticles of biological interest, and there were a billion of them. And, the classification ended up using only, I think, 9 characteristics out of perhaps 20 potential ones. And able to characterize all of them.
I had a question. It was a fascinating talk. I guess my initial reaction is a little bit of a discomfort, and I'll explain why. I'm probably wrong, but I guess I'm totally okay with my advertising and my cat face recognition being done with basically very complicated methods. Frankly, aesthetically, I like my physics to be simple, transparent, and open. Maybe I'm on this, and I'm not a physicist, but that's the way I like my physics and math.
Remember, we have tools at our disposal to give us comfort.
I'm just saying this is my emotional reaction. I'm totally okay with cat faces being to be honest, and I'm quasi in this area, but I mean I have to say it just sounds really complicated. And I'm hoping and assuming that these things are very carefully cross-validated, because if someone walks up to you on the street and says, I have this fantastically complicated data analysis method, then the very least you should do, even if you can't understand what it is or if no one understands what it is, the very least you should do is be confident that it's actually doing something and they're not just saying, look, I produced a bunch of good pictures. So I'm assuming that these things are very carefully validated out of sample and with, you know, cross-validation, this thing. Tell me yes, and I'll feel better.
Yes. So what would we do? We would take our classical methods. We would take simulations and show that, you know, compared to our classical methods, we're getting the same characteristics. It's giving the same answers and has somewhat higher sensitivity. And we do this with our simulated data. We say, you know, we can take real data. We can take simulated data where we know what's going on inside. We make the simulated data look on the surface very much like the real data. And we can say that we can actually extract the signals in the simulated data that we know are buried there and compare to our classical methods of analysis and say, hey, we're getting the same results, but you know, there's this marginal improvement. Like the MBA analysis I showed you had a factor of 1.8 in significance after a lot of work and a lot of cross-validation, and all the components in that flow chart were cross-validated. This is even much more complicated, but things are advancing a lot, and we like to not only collaborate but contribute to advanced technologies on behalf of our science program. And because it lasts 20 years, we have a long attention span, at least, you know, as groups of people. And so we're very careful, and when there's a real opportunity, you know, we try to take advantage of it, but we are very careful, and we won't do anything unless we're certain. Yeah.
Hello. Thank you again for the great talk. And my name is Dan Fellam. I'm mainly using with data reduction techniques. And my question related to the previous questions. So usually you talk about a lot about the size of the data that you collect, the exabytes of data. You didn't mention too much the complexity of the models. Another thing that we learned is that in data reduction, it doesn't matter how much data you have, is the complexity of the hidden models. For example, if you're watching cars in the street, you can also collect exabytes of data by taking every nanosecond the position of the car, but doesn't matter what, the model, how the cars are moving is what's important. And I wonder how complicated are the models you use, and again, why they are so complicated. Usually in physics, the equations are so simple and elegant. We don't need so sophisticated models. So why here we need this deep learning and all this large models for analyzing natural phenomena in some sense?
Well, because we're producing a tremendous amount of processes we already understand. And if you look at all possible processes, as you get more and more data, they also look kind of interesting topologically. There are lots of particles produced. I don't just mean the tracks you saw, but multiple heavy particles, multiple jets. And you have to separate the signals from backgrounds, which as the intensity goes up, themselves get more and more interesting. So the question is, in this mass of data, is there any subtle effect which is hidden? Some of them, we just have to create tons, go through tons of data until we get to the point where we even expect that they're produced, like the very rare decays of the Higgs boson. Others, the main point is there are probably things in our data that we don't expect. And so we have to carefully try to isolate those things. Now, we're very much limited by how much computing it takes to go through processing all of our data. And that's a very tough limit. So we're very open to find computationally less intensive ways, whether it is new methods related to deep learning or whether it's neuromorphic processors with much greater power to recognize certain patterns and much lower energy. We're open to try these things and see if they can bring us breakthroughs. If in any even part of these things we have a breakthrough, what it means in the end is one of two things might happen. One is we might make a discovery that otherwise we would never reach. Two is if we reduce the computational burden, we can actually expand the scope of what we do. You know, our investigations are very many and very big, but we have to compromise because of practicality. So if we reduce the computing burden, we'd be able to do more. You know, so that's the hope.
maybe, I don't know, one, well, there were two. Okay, we'll do, okay, Balaji, and this will be our last question, and we'll try.
Hi, Harvey. This is Balaji Prabhakar. I have more a comment. I actually completely relate to the spirit of your talk. I've been working on large-scale transportation networks and also on data centers. And the idea of, like, from snapshot observations to reconstruct some complicated dynamical system, and we call that the T-minus problem, T being the current time. So yeah. Just historically reconstruct what happened. But also the T-plus problems are this real-time inference and emulation. Yeah. In computer networks, we have very detailed emulators, and they just get better enabled to just sort of tell us how a network may evolve. But sometimes the algorithms are so complex that they take longer to reconstruct than might be helpful, or longer to predict what's going to happen. So we found this sort of neural networks useful in short-circuiting the amount of time from observing something to having a classification or an output. So it's more a runtime benefit.
We would be very interested in those. I mean, you know, it's a form of anomaly detection. So in these complex systems, management is not so difficult if everything is normal. But for any one of a number of reasons, some have to do with the network, some have to do with anomalies at the sites or in storage systems, all of these things. To localize, when you have the first detection, to localize an anomaly, to characterize it, to make a reasonable decision, because often people make decisions which are just so divorced from what really happened that it just does more damage than help. So being able to do this quickly is very important in real time. I'm very interested in that.
Okay. So thanks a lot, Harvey, for coming to us all the way from Geneva, more or less.
It's very exciting here. Let's play.
Okay, great. And I'm sure you'll welcome more questions by email, because we sort of cut off a few Absolutely. People here, or at least one person.
I think okay, there's a lot perfect. Of opportunity, and you know, that's part of the purpose of my talk.
Right, I agree. Okay, thanks a lot. And
thanks a lot.